Welcome to Life Unrestricted.
This is your show if you're sick of living a life controlled by food and exercise rules, and if you're ready to learn how to accept yourself and enjoy the heck out of life. My gig is about body image, femininity, self-worth, and resilience. Come on, let's walk side by side as we slowly step out of restriction, misery, and unlock our true selves.
Your host, Merit Boxler, is a former national radio DJ, freelance journalist, speaker, and writer with a passion to make women feel good in their bodies. This is a show brought to you live from Switzerland.
Hello, lovely radicals. Welcome to another, yes, crazy, in the very best sense of the word, ride on the Life Unrestricted podcast. Today's going to be awesome. I mean, we've got Marya Hornbacher on the show. And I don't know about you, but I'm pretty damn giddy about that. But first, I want to say thank you. Thank you for hearing me. As I was telling you in my recent solo episode, when I was talking about having spoken to one of my longtime Patreons of the show, Rob, I found out that there often is the misperception that I must be making great money with this show and that there must be huge numbers of people contributing to this show's existence. But as I told you, that sadly isn't the case. While there are often more than 10,000 listeners per episode, which is fucking awesome, there are only 36 Patreons. And there is a lot of fluctuation also. Some become Patreons, and by the time I get to thank them on the show, they've already canceled again, which is of course a totally legitimate choice. But just to illustrate, no matter for how long someone is a Patreon of this show, which means being a supporter, the fact remains that there are only very precious few who actually support the show. And it really is those people who are making this entire thing possible, since I have no business attached to this podcast, as most others do, being coaches or therapists or dietitians. And without the people who support this show, I would never be able to afford keeping the work up, because it's just too costly and too time-consuming. And if you're asking yourself, well, why doesn't she just start coaching people? I have to say that would not be a good idea. I'm in recovery myself, and it really is no business of people in recovery to be coaching people who need help, because we're not recovered yet. As much as I'd love to do that one day, maybe, this wouldn't be a responsible thing to do at the moment, and I'm not out to make bucks by telling other people what to do. So, long story short, I cannot tell you how happy it made me to see that I've got three new Patreons to celebrate. Amazing! Thank you, thank you, thank you, Susie, Sarah, and Kathleen, for becoming my newest Patreons. You are such badasses, and you're really making a difference. You supporting me means that this message keeps getting out, which means you are actively helping to maybe save a soul or two, or maybe 2,000, from going down the dark rabbit hole of a lifetime of dieting, weight cycling, weight obsession, shame, exercise compulsion, or maybe even an eating disorder. This week, Susie, Sarah, and Kathleen get to be every listener's heroes. Thank you. And for anyone who's also willing to consider supporting the show, please feel free and have a look at patreon.com/lifeunrestricted. Your pledge means a lot, and as I alluded to earlier, of course you can cancel at any time. Again, you can find my donation page at patreon.com/lifeunrestricted. And now that that's said, I invite you for a very special ride. In today's episode of the Life Unrestricted podcast, I'm talking to Marya Hornbacher from Minneapolis. Marya is known for many things. She's an assistant professor of writing arts at Rowan University in Glassboro, New Jersey. She's also an award-winning journalist, and as most of you might know, she's a best-selling author, most known for her memoir on anorexia called Wasted, which was published when she was only 22 years old. 10 years later, she published her second memoir on bipolar disorder called Madness, and after those two memoirs, she published an acclaimed novel called The Center of Winter. And after that came two books about mental health, addiction, recovery, and spirituality, one called Sane and the other one Waiting. And Marya has a lot more in the works, but we will talk about that in the interview. As you might know, Marya's memoir, Wasted, which as I said, she wrote around 20 years ago, is one of the best known eating disorder memoirs there are. And it's a literary masterpiece. It's a book, however, that she has gotten quite some flack for because there were people who described the book as too triggering, too dark, and too descriptive, and hence not safe to read for people with a predisposition for eating disorders. Since Marya was only at the beginning of her recovery and also very young when she wrote the book, she took that criticism to heart and republished the book with an important foreword. And I would like to read some parts of it to you as an introduction to the beautiful talk I had with her. So here we go. I am not here to repeat at length how eating disorders are, quote, about control, unquote, because we've all heard it. It's a buzzword, reductive, categorical, a tidy way of herding people into a mental quarantine and saying, there, that's that. Eating disorders are, quote-unquote, about, yes, control, and history, philosophy, society, personal strangeness, family fuck-ups, autoerotics, myth, mirrors, love and death, magazines and religion, the individual's blindfolded stumble walk through an ever-stranger world. The question is really not if eating disorders are, quote-unquote, neurotic, and indicate a glitch in the mind, because even I would have a hard time justifying rationally the practice of starving oneself to death or feasting only to toss back the feast, but rather why? Why this glitch? What flipped the switch? Why so many of us? Why now? Some toxin in the air? Some freak of nature that has turned women against their own bodies with a violence unmatched in history all of a sudden, with no cause? The individual does not exist outside of society. There are reasons why this is happening, and they do not lie in the mind alone. This book is neither a tabloid tale of mysterious disease nor a testimony to a miracle cure. It is simply the story of one woman's travels to a darker side of reality and her decision to make her way back on her own terms. I had to say, I will eat what I want and look as I please and laugh as loud as I like and use the wrong fork and lick my knife. I had to learn strange and delicious lessons, lessons too few women learn, to love the thump of my steps, the implication of weight and presence and taking of space, to love my body's rebellious hungers, responses to touch, to understand myself as more than a brain attached to a bundle of bones. I have to ignore the cultural cacophony that sings songs all day long, too much, too much, too much. As Abra Fortune Chernik writes, gaining weight and pulling my head out of the toilet was the most political act I ever committed. I wrote this book because I believe some people will recognize themselves in it, eating disordered or not, and because I believe, perhaps naively, that they might be willing to change their own behavior, get help if they need it, entertain the notion that their bodies are acceptable, that they themselves are neither insufficient nor in excess. I wrote it because I disagree with much of what is generally believed about eating disorders and wanted to put in my two cents for whatever it's worth. I wrote it because people often dismiss eating disorders as manifestations of vanity, immaturity, madness. It is in some ways all of these things, but it is also an addiction. It is a response, albeit a rather twisted one, to a culture, a family, a self. I wrote this because I want to dispel two common and contradictory myths about eating disorders, that they are an insignificant problem solved by a little therapy and a little pill and a pat on the head, a quote-unquote stage that quote-unquote girls go through. An eating disorder is not usually a phase, and it is not necessarily indicative of madness. It is quite maddening, granted, not only for the loved ones of the eating disordered person, but also for the person herself. It is, at the most basic level, a bundle of deadly contradictions, a desire for power that strips you of all power, a gesture of strength that divests you of all strength, a wish to prove that you need nothing, that you have no human hungers, which turns on itself and becomes a searing need for the hunger itself. It is an attempt to find an identity, but ultimately it strips you of any sense of yourself, save the sorry identity of quote-unquote sick. It is a grotesque mockery of cultural standards of beauty that winds up mocking no one more than you. It is a protest against cultural stereotypes of women that in the end makes you seem the weakest, the most needy and neurotic of all women. It is the thing you believe is keeping you alive, safe, contained, and in the end, of course, you find it's doing quite the opposite. These contradictions begin to split a person in two. Body and mind fall apart from each other, and it is in this fissure that an eating disorder may flourish, in the silence that surrounds this confusion, that an eating disorder may fester and thrive. An eating disorder is in many ways a rather logical elaboration on a cultural idea. While the personality of an eating disorder person plays a huge role, and while the family of an eating disorder person plays a fairly crucial part in creating an environment in which an eating disorder may grow like a hot house flower, I do believe that the cultural environment is an equal, if not greater, culprit in the sheer popularity of eating disorders. There were numerous methods of self-destruction available to me, countless outlets that could have channeled my drive, perfectionism, ambition, and an excess of general intensity, millions of ways in which I could have responded to a culture that I found highly problematic. I cannot help but think that, had I lived in a culture where, quote-unquote, thinness was not regarded as a strange state of grace, I might have sought out another means of attaining that grace, perhaps one that would not have so seriously damaged my body and so radically distorted my sense of who I am. I do not have all the answers. In fact, I have precious few. I will pose more questions in this book that I can respond to. I can offer little more than my perspective, my experience of having an eating disorder. It is not an unusual experience. I was sicker than some, not as sick as others. I would do anything to keep people from going where I went. Writing this book was the only thing I could think of. Wow. You know, I do think that, as it is with most memoirs, it's very important to never forget the context and the time in which they were written, and to not judge a person for telling the story of their suffering at the stage they were in when they wrote the memoir. Marya's life and her tireless work for people with eating disorders and other mental illnesses speak for themselves. To me, Marya is a truly fascinating and incredibly beautiful and warm-hearted soul, and I am so glad and honored that I got to speak to her. So let's jump in. First things first, let's welcome our guest. Hi, Marya. Thank you for coming on the Life Unrestricted podcast today.
Well, I'm so happy to.
Thank you. I told you already, I had a really hard time preparing for this conversation because there's just so much I'd like to say and I'd like to ask. And there's so many angles from which to potentially start this conversation. So in the end, I think out of sheer mental overwhelm, I decided not to overthink it and just let it go where it goes. But I'll just start this conversation by saying thank you for being you and for helping to destigmatize topics like eating disorders, mental illness, addiction. So thank you for writing and talking about these issues, and thank you for being here.
Yeah, absolutely. It's, you know, it's in its own way a pleasure to do the work.
In its own way, right. Yeah. So how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. I feel incredibly lucky. You know, I feel lucky that I went through some of this stuff because I don't know that everybody has the opportunity to really consider how do I want to live? You know what I mean? That sounds odd, but when you've gone through some difficult stuff, I think it really gives you the opportunity to make choices later about how do I want to live? How do I want to take care of myself? What do I want to do with my life? I think when you've faced a dead end, you get the opportunity to reroute, you know? Mm-hmm. So I feel really good today. Thank you.
You're welcome. Before I ask you anything deep, I want to come out and tell you that I've only, in air quotes, read your two memoirs, Wasted and Madness, so far. And it seems like I'm a bit late to the party since those were your first two books and Wasted came out about 20 years ago. But well, here I am, 43 years old, coming to terms with my own history of having gotten misdiagnosed myriad times and feeling like something was broken beyond repair with myself, like I was chasing my own tail, trying to fix this brokenness. And your two memoirs, fantastic and dark as they are, and desperate and deep, they are also indescribable. So before I lose myself in stammering praise, let's assume my listeners have not read your work and are curious about what I'm going on about. So let's talk about your life. Let's go on all the tangents that need going on. How did you feel in your body as a child?
As a child, that's a great question. I felt very, at first, when I was quite young, I felt very at home. I was really a tomboy. I was athletic. I loved to be outside. I think it was when I began to be aware of the larger world outside of my yard that I really took on a great deal of sense of shame about my body and about its femininity. It's, you know, I say that in air quotes as well. But its nature is to be, I'm very confident now, but for many years I was terribly unconfident and felt like it looked and felt uncomfortable to me. And I think the eating disorder stemmed in great part from that discomfort.
Did you pick that up from your parents? I mean, I know it from your books, but was there a lot of dieting and diet talk and, you know, the performing perfectionistic ideals in your family?
Good question. And yes, there was a lot of body consciousness, a lot of discomfort in the body. My parents came from very different angles on that. My mother struggled with, I think she struggled with wanting to be thinner than was necessary. My father struggled with eating more than he felt was comfortable. And so my consciousness of it was always very heightened because of the talk.
Were you criticized for your hunger?
I was. And I think that came in more an emotional sense than in a physiological. Like, it wasn't so much you're eating too much, although certainly there was comment of that. What I felt was more emotionally hungry than physically hungry. And I think that was what I pursued so desperately, was to not be emotionally hungry as much as it was to not be physically hungry. You know, eating disorders are in some ways very metaphorical. I think we're trying to stamp out physiological and mental and emotional need through them. And that was what I tried to do quite young.
I heard from Dr. Anita Johnston also that it's often the very sensitive child that develops an eating disorder when she or he is overwhelmed at her home with stuff that is going on, or when he or she feels too much and is not allowed to express themselves, or when the parents are simply not in a position to deal with the child's sensitivity or their display of emotions. So they either starve it away or stuff it down or find other stages on which to perform their anxiety and their feelings.
So true. So very true. I think I have not met a person who has struggled with eating disorders who wasn't unusually sensitive. But I think that's such a, in its own way, a stigmatized word. People will say, oh, she's so sensitive. I don't think that means oversensitive. I think it means very alert. I think it means very conscious of the world in which you live, the emotions of your own self, the emotions of other people, and what's going on. So it becomes an asset if you can train it. But as a child, of course, that means you feel an onslaught of emotional and other kinds of information. And I think that does get overwhelming. And when there's a household situation of some chaos, that becomes overwhelming as well. I think Anita is very right on that point.
Yeah, I experienced the same. I think I couldn't have dealt with the sheer craziness, pardon the punch, in my own home. So I kind of attached to food in an unhealthy way. Plus, I had a mom also who was addicted and dieted and, you know, didn't like her body and didn't relate to herself as a feminine, or as we now would describe, a feminine and embodied woman. So there's also cultural influence in all that. And we pick it all up. So Wasted, your eating disorder memoir that you wrote almost 20 years ago, was the first book of you that I read and found it spectacularly well written. And I don't think I'm the only one with that sort of opinion. And it's very gripping and at the same time so dark that it almost felt dangerous to read at times. And I mean, I'm 43, so I'm assuming that it's not easy for you to look back on that book.
It's not. That's very true. I think the culture at that time, when the book came out in the late 90s, was very different. There was no conversation, no active pop culture conversation about eating disorders, except to very, very much glamorize the disorders. The pop culture now has changed enormously. And so there's quite a lot of reactivity to women's stories. There's quite a lot of reactivity to the idea of talking about some of this stuff. And so there's been a significant backlash with the cultural change that, you know, the book was written into was hungrier for stories, if I can use that, and women's stories needed to be recognized and validated. And so I think it was important at that time. Of course, what has happened is now we're very afraid of critiquing our own culture, critiquing our own selves in some way. And so the book does feel, I think, to me even, dangerous and problematic. It really does.
You got criticized for it being potentially triggering or even encouraging for people with eating disorders. I personally don't think that's true, but I understand where the criticism is coming from. So you wrote an afterword, and I'd like you to describe what you wrote, because actually I find it's the most important part and the most beautiful part of the book.
Thank you. I really feel it's the only important part of the book at this point.
True.
But of course, as a writer, you always go, oh, well, what I wrote 20 years later was better. And you would hope so as a writer to change and evolve as a writer. But also my thinking has changed and evolved quite a bit. When I wrote the book, I was very, very young. I am also 43 now. I wrote it when I was 22. And I don't know what anybody else was doing when they were 22, but I was not at my wisest.
Neither was I. Sorry for laughing. But I was just thinking back of my own self. Yeah.
I think it's really accurate that none of us has really kind of got our wits together yet. And I was very much an emotional case of, I don't know, I was in a very emotionally dissolved sort of place. I wanted to speak out against eating disorders. And at that time, speaking about them at all was an act of resistance against the disorders. Now, of course, speaking about them is so taboo. To speak about the difficulties and the non-glamorous aspects of them. But the book at the time, people thought it was horrifying. And now, of course, there's this, oh, women and men will think this is appealing. And to find that book appealing, you have to be already sick. Mm-hmm. You really have to be in a place where disaster looks appealing. And so the idea that it causes, that talking about eating disorders causes eating disorders, is like talking about sex. It won't happen if you don't talk about it. Of course, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
It's ridiculous. But it's also true that the book can be triggering. And I'm very aware of that. And that's something the word triggering was not in common parlance in 1997 and 98 when I wrote it. We didn't talk about what was triggering because we didn't know anything about eating disorders, really. We didn't know how to treat them. We didn't know what was dangerous. We didn't know what was problematic. And so telling the story straight out was a good idea at that time. Now I would do it in a very different way. And so the afterword was really to take a look at the ending, which was that in the end of It Wasted, when I wrote it, I really didn't believe in recovery. Then I recovered. So I had to write a follow-up and say, you know, actually, there are other alternatives. There are options for how this can turn out. It's really a choice of ending, how you want to go on with your disorder or if you want to cut it off.
Yeah, you did. And you had a beautiful way of putting it. Like, you didn't gloss over the fact that recovery is a messy fucking process and Right. It's not comfortable.
It's not comfortable. And I think one of the things about addictions of any kind, certainly this is my experience with this addiction and with other addictions, uncomfortable is like the worst state you can be in. Mm. It's almost like pain is easier because pain, you know. Well, pain, you kind of know, you can understand. Like Chekhov said, any idiot can handle a crisis. I've always loved that line. But it's also very true that discomfort is very hard for us to tolerate. And we spend a lot of time in the modern world trying to avoid discomfort. And that's how addictions function. And so recovery, of course, is uncomfortable. And you get to go through that. But what the benefit of that, what the blessing of that is that you really evolve as a person into a calmer, steadier, more adaptable human being through recovery.
Mm-hmm. I was going to ask two things. First of all, I'm going to piggyback on what you said. If you were advising your younger self in that writing process of Wasted, what would you tell her to change or to write differently?
Two things majorly. We didn't know at the time that numbers were so problematic. I wouldn't use the numbers, the weights, the sizes, all of that. I would make the book weight neutral, but we didn't know anything about that then either. So I had no real guidance. If I could guide myself now, I would say wait until the culture has changed a little bit to bring this up so that there is more of a sense of how it will be understood by the popular culture. I would also say wait until you're older to make any decisions about whether you can or cannot recover, because the need later to go back and say, okay, that ending where I didn't recover isn't the ending. And so I would tell myself to wait.
But at the same time, I mean, when we look at the effect the book had on the world, then it also seems like it was necessary to be published at the time it was, because there was nobody speaking up.
That's true.
That's true. Maybe the other side, yeah.
I think whenever somebody speaks up on an issue in culture, there is backlash. There's necessarily backlash because that's how we come to balance, you know. And so you say something quite fierce, someone will say something opposing quite fiercely. And that's okay. I understand that that's otherwise known as the dialectic. It's the dialogue we have. And that's good, and that's to our benefit. I think there has not been enough of an answer to eating disorders. We don't know much about them still, and we don't really fully believe in recovery yet. And so there is no counterpoint to our idea of eating disorders as permanent. And what we need is a very strong recovery voice saying, this is not a permanent condition, you can change this.
Yeah, and many of the therapists and specialists I talked to, they were very much in favor of the idea that there is full recovery and this can be overcome.
Yeah.
And I just want to stress that because it's an important message. What was the effect that book had on you?
Well, I went into a kind of hiding for a number of years there. I didn't publish another book until I was 30, I think 30. And so I went into hiding for about 7 years. I did things like finished college. I went into graduate school. I taught. I went on with my life. And I really needed to do that to get my distance on that book so I could go on with my writing, you know, so I could evolve as a writer. I needed to go back to school. I needed to finish writing. My awareness of the hubbub around the book needed to be limited. And so I limited it. I had said what I had come to say. I needed to go back into myself and into my own studies to think about what I wanted to say next. And so really, I protected myself pretty carefully from the backlash and from the success of it. You know, I really kind of sidestepped thinking about it because I found it overwhelming and I didn't really understand it. I didn't really understand it. And so I didn't pay a whole lot of attention.
Yeah. What strikes me as, you know, tragic in a way is that you were only in the process, as we all are, I mean, for the entirety of our lives, but you were only trying to put together the jigsaw puzzle of yourself and what was, quote unquote, wrong, you know, with your mind and what was going on. And you only discovered what might be the problem later on when you were already successful and people wanted to talk to you about eating disorders and you were kind of grappling with your own sanity, so to say. And yes. So how was that transition like when you discovered, well, now that one thing is treated, it's like a game of whack-a-mole.
Whack-a-mole, yeah.
Yeah, you have the eating disorder under control and all of a sudden you're drinking like a mad person. And then I so relate to all that the whole addiction transfer. And still, all of those things are just symptoms of a larger picture that you couldn't have figured out before because you didn't have an idea what the picture was even. So I so relate to that. Fumbling in the dark, what is wrong with me, and getting right. Misdiagnosed potentially. So how was that?
That was very confusing. I found myself, I think more than anything, I was trying to make sense of what was wrong. As you say, it's like putting a jigsaw puzzle together when you don't know what the picture is you're trying to make. And so I think one of the things that I did is quite common, is I found it necessary to see chaos and train wreck as a kind of identity. I really understood myself as chaos. You know, I was like, I'm a tornado, I'm a mess, I'm a wreck, this is just who I am. When I realized that also was not necessary and that I could A, get support and B, really work through myself, who I was beyond that, that became the recovery point, was really when I began to see I'm not just a diagnosis, I'm not just an addiction, I'm not any of these things really. Those are kind of the negative theology of what we are when we realize that it's important to be a self and not to be a black hole of trouble. I really had a hard time redefining, and that was the period in which I was struggling to find a diagnosis, to get pharmaceutical help with that, to get therapy for that. And so for many years, I really just flailed.
It seems like your own quote-unquote madness dragged you behind itself and, you know, yeah. through the dirt, and you were kind of not keeping up with what it was doing with you and to you. Or at least that's how it feels like when I read your book. Like every other week you were thinking, okay, I got this under control. And then, you know, not taking your medication anymore, and off you went again. And then you got the wrong medications, and off you went again. And then you were felt great and you didn't take the medications and you had no idea. And that's so common that we get misdiagnosed. And I don't have bipolar disorder, but I have a whole plethora of diagnoses, from OCD to anxiety disorder and eating disorder and all sorts of stuff. You know, depression and anxiety, everything is in there, and ADHD. And after a while, I thought, well, I am nothing but broken, obviously. So what the hell is going on? And it took me a very long time. And it's like a little over 2 years ago, we found out that it was complex post-traumatic stress disorder, very much related from when I was a kid, from 15 years of, you know, fighting for my life. And I thought I had that under control because I am so brave and so self-reliant. And I didn't recognize my own behaviors were just an attempt, A, at appearing normal, and wanting to be like everybody else and not understanding why I didn't seem to fit in ever. And then also numbing the noise in my head, the feelings, the anxiety, the not knowing who I am. And for a while that worked pretty nicely and I got pretty popular in my country, even, you know, as a national radio person. And I got all the admiration, and inside I felt emptier and emptier and more at a loss as to what's wrong. So I find it is really, really important to talk about eating disorders as a symptom of a larger picture, and not just, I mean, there are people who suffer from an eating disorder, period, and then they can get treated for that and they will be better. But for a large number of people, there is, you know, there are comorbidities that can be crippling, and it takes a lot of time to finally make sense what the real problem is when you get diagnoses of symptoms of a bigger picture.
Right. And one of the things there, if I can take a bit, piggyback on that a bit, One of the things I'm learning in my research on the new book is that diagnosis has in psychiatric worlds has always been based on symptoms. We don't know very much about the organic causes of any of these things. What I feel is necessary is that we start looking, first of all, science can go ahead and look for those organic causes, and I think that's critically important. But we, as people who are not necessarily neuroscientists, need to look at what are the causes within our own lives and within our own culture, because if we don't look at those, we keep going, well, this must be the problem. This here, we're going to pin it on this. And then that pin falls out and you have to put another pin in and go, oh, well, actually, maybe it's this. Well, the truth of it is that we don't know very much about what those diagnoses mean. And so misdiagnosis, of course, is rampant. I think it's the recognition that there is something underneath there that needs to be addressed, some kind of hurt, some kind of, whether it's physiological or whether it's emotionally pure and simple, those underlying causes have to be addressed, or that whack-a-mole game never ends. You know, you keep on whapping away at these things.
Yeah, I recognize myself in your story, even though I don't have bipolar. It's not even about what the final diagnosis or the correct diagnosis really is, but it's a problem when we get different confusing diagnoses that make us feel hopeless and unfixable in the end. And what strikes me is also that you had the experience of being given the wrong medications. And even when you started to speak up for yourself and saying, no, I don't need Prozac, I think it was, because that will exacerbate the problem, that the medical person that was prescribing the medication was not even able to hear you and was trying to put the, yes, you got to increase the dosage and I know what you need. And you knew it was going to, you know, lead you into disaster. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Absolutely. I think that's a real dynamic that exists in the mental health fields, which is that, well, you're crazy, I must know better than you. But the fact is that we know ourselves and can know ourselves quite well as people who deal with mental health disorders. And so when I found that nobody would listen to what I had to say about my own mind, I became frustrated and started to educate myself very carefully so that I was at least able to keep pace with what I was being told I had to do. I think I had dealt so long with people saying, well, this will fix you, this will do it, this is the answer, that I began to stop trusting myself about what I knew to be true about my mind. And so eventually I had to regain that trust in myself and say, no, I am the authority on my mind. You guys may know a lot about medication, but I will tell you how my mind works and not the other way around. That was a vital piece in empowering myself to move past, well, I guess I'll take it because they told me to, or I guess I won't take it because I'm scared of it. You know, educating myself was really vital, really vital.
And what did you experience when you took the wrong medications? Plus, you drank a lot and they didn't even make you stop drinking.
No, they didn't.
Why?
I mean, that's one of those conflicts between fields where people in psychiatry really feel that you're self-medicating if you're drinking, and people in the substance abuse world think that you're an addict, pure and simple, and that there is no mental health thing. That's a very, very blunt way of putting it. It's much, much, much too generalized. But the point is that psychiatry did not think the problem was my drinking. Psychiatry thought that the problem was my mental health. And I'm like, how did you separate those? You know, what was the mix up there where you didn't see how intricately those were related? But yeah, mismedication is, you know, it's dangerous. But at the same time, I do take medication now, and I find it very, very helpful in creating balance for my mind and my mental health. So I don't want people to be scared of medication. I think the thing I hear the most is that people are afraid it will stump their creativity, which is not the case if you get on the right medication. But the mismedication really does create some problems for people. And that's why I think we need to educate ourselves about what are my tendencies? What are my symptoms? So that when the doctor says, how do you feel? You don't just say bad. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You don't just say, I feel terrible, fix it. So I think that self-driven care of your own mind is important, because if you don't have that information about yourself, mismedication and mistreatment is very easy.
Oh, yeah. Why do you think it took so many rounds of suffering and having another episode or periods of episodes and suffering tremendously for years and being unpredictable to yourself and not understanding yourself? Why do you think it took so long for you to finally find a key piece of that puzzle?
There were a couple of key pieces. The first one, and this I really felt was fundamental, I needed to stop using substances because there was no way to find a baseline of my mind or mental health without, while I was still pouring substances, mind-altering substances into my body. You know, how do you find out how you feel if you're drunk? Well, you're drunk. That's how you feel. And so really what I had to do there was stop with the addictive drinking and drug use. I just had to stop. Once I did that, I was able to figure out, okay, what are the real organic symptoms that I experience of mental health disorder? And so that, from there, I was armed with knowledge. Until that time, it was just a moving target. Until that time, it was really, I had no idea where to begin to get to the bottom of the issue because I didn't know where the top and the bottom of the issue were. And so I think that, in addition to the fact that this is a while ago, we didn't know as much about the disorders as we do now, I think it was, you know, a combination of my confusion and the confusion within the fields, the mental health fields. We kind of made a perfect storm of my mind for a long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And also what I think can be very disheartening is that whatever we might be recovering from, and as I like to say, we're all recovering from something, that we hold on to this hope that once I get this eating disorder under control, I'll be fine. Or once I get this alcohol addiction under control, or the drug addiction, or gambling, or, you know, engaging in risky sexual behavior, or whatever it is, then I'll be fine. But as you so pointedly described in your book, it is not, you know, when we get the disease under control that we will be fine. It's actually only then that the journey starts. And I'd like to pick your brains on that, because I think that's often overlooked as well, and people get discouraged and fall back into their disorder.
That's very true. And I saw, now looking back, of course, I can see how I did that periodically. I would start to get the eating disorder or the drinking or whatever under control, and then the healing would start. And I'd be like, healing is hard. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to live without these various and sundry addictive behaviors. That journey really does, as you say, begin when you get to the baseline and begin when you start accruing knowledge and self-empowerment. And I think it is easy to get discouraged because it's a long process. Recovery is a long process. And if anybody says, no, it's pretty quick and easy, you can pretty much find yourself another provider because they don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
I think the deal is you need to be prepared to really invest in your own self. And that's hard sometimes after many years of self-hatred because of the illnesses. I think it's super important to get to, I'm going to take care of myself. I'm going to save myself. I'm going to reclaim my life. And I'm going to invest the time in that. You know, we've invested a huge amount of time in self-destruction. You need to put that time toward the investment in yourself instead.
But at the start of recovery, didn't you find that your impulse to self-harm or self-loathe or have self-loathing thoughts was even more intense?
I did, because at first, you know, I had a therapist many years ago who said that the mind abhors dissonance. We don't like it when our experience is clashing with our perception. So when I started recovering, especially from eating disorders, and was like, okay, now you're going to eat because eating is good. Well, I had trained myself to think eating was not good for 20 years. And then you really do need to make that leap of faith into believing that health is right for you and health is possible for you. I think that's when you've defined yourself as a screw up for so long, it's very hard to say, I could have a better life. But until you say that, why would you try if you don't believe you can have that better life? You have to take that leap of faith. When I started recovering from the eating disorders, it was very dissonant in my mind to think, okay, I need to gain weight. I want to gain weight, whatever. You know, I need to be healthy. I need to be taking care of my body, because you're so used to destroying yourself. And that feels natural and right after a certain amount of time. That's hard to explain to people who've never experienced the disorder, is that it feels natural and right to harm yourself. Mm-hmm. In recovery, you have to move into that feels wrong. I don't want to harm myself any further. I don't need to go backwards again. And that recognition that you can, in fact, close the door on it is a leap of faith, because it feels like it's pulling on you for such a long time. It feels like it's really tugging at you. And until you go, it does not run my life, I run my life, until you realize you can do that and just walk away from it, it's a painful and difficult period of time.
Mm-hmm. In the context of what you know about yourself now, how do you understand your own eating disorders when you look back?
Oh boy, I think I was very, very frightened. I think I was frightened of the world. I was frightened of my mind. I was frightened of myself. I was frightened of other people. You name it, I was frightened. Eating disorders for me became a way of controlling that fear. And it was possible for me to invest all that fear and all that energy and all that whatever into something very simple that was literally numerical in nature. I could say, okay, if I just add these things up, then this logical thing will occur. And when I needed to step away from that, I needed to recognize that life is pretty amorphous and that fear comes and goes and that pain comes and goes in the same way. So when I look at it now, I look at it as this terribly, terribly profound fear of pain, a terribly profound fear of change, a profound fear of emotion. And now, when I deal with things like discomfort or uncomfortable emotions, it's possible to go, well, that's just an emotion, and not translate it immediately into self-abuse.
Yeah. Why do you think you got hooked on alcohol after the eating disorder was more or less under control?
I think it was just the next way to distract myself from how I felt. I just found it to be an effective mechanism of controlling what eventually I realized were mood swings, endemic to the bipolar. What it was I tried very hard to replace a good feeling in myself with something that would make me feel good. I had no sense that I could be happy or sufficient or good enough on my own. And I reached for addictions to supplant that. And I also tried to control my mood swings with substances. I think it was an easy jump from eating disorders to alcohol. I think that was just like, well, I do something too much. I'm just going to do this other thing too much. And, you know, when people tell you, oh, you have such an addictive personality, that's actually, I think, quite damaging, because then you go, oh, well, this is endemic to me. I just have this addictive personality and I have no way to step away from it. I think it's really important to recognize that addictive is not a personality. Addictive is a substance or an action, and we choose those, probably not consciously, I'm sure not consciously. We do have to make that conscious choice, though, to step away. That's important.
Yeah, it is. And what also happens often is the other way around, that people who get their drinking under control, that might have been their primary addiction, that they end up, you know, not eating enough. Yep. Or being exercise addicts. That happens to a lot of people. I was invited to an NA meeting just as a guest, which was very, very interesting. And some people who were in recovery, especially men, were extremely exercise addicted, you know, talking about the only thing that kind of calms their mind is going to the gym every day and being buff and becoming obsessive about what they eat and healthy eating, and almost orthorexic women. Yes. And almost every woman I talked to was battling an unhealthy relationship with food, being totally restrictive, being orthorexic about, you know, their food choices, being very, very strict and addicted to exercise. And I was like, oh, there's so much addiction transfer happening the other way around as well. But no one catches that, because exercise addiction is good, isn't it? It's better than having a drug addiction. And I'm here to say, no, it's not actually better.
Right. So true. It's not better. And I think, you know, at the core, psychological, spiritual, internal level, we transfer those around because we are, I believe, and I can say, I will speak for myself on this front, the transfer from eating disorders to exercise to alcohol, it's kind of moot which your behavior is. You're doing something obsessively. And we do it, I think, to give ourselves a sense of control. You know, I know that's very hackneyed in thinking about some of these disorders, but we do it to give ourselves a sense that we can control ourselves, recognizing eventually that the outside is never going to control the internal. That's an important moment. to recognize that I need to make choices about how I care for myself, those will give me the sense of control that I'm seeking. But yes, absolutely. I see people all the time in the recovery from substances community whose eating relationships are deeply disordered. And it's very hard to explain to them, you know, this is just as damaging to you because they come from an experience of terrible, terrible struggle with substances. And the world tells them, no, eating disorders, exercise, all of this stuff is its own way of being healthy. And that myth of healthy obsession is very, very important that we start to address.
Yeah. I mean, it's getting totally crazy these days. We live in a world that has its own disordered eating going on. And at every corner, you know, it's being promoted as healthy. Yeah. And people have their own YouTube channels promoting their disordered eating. I mean, when you and I, when we grew up way back in the 1900s, there was an absence of social media and the internet. And I think, I mean, you have to speak for yourself, but I think I could have been way worse off.
Oh, God, yes.
If I had access to, you know, with the mind that I had back then, I would have gobbled up all the wrong advice.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think with the amount of misinformation and misrepresentation in the social media forums, you know, humans are group thinkers in some way. We're trained to behave with the group. And one of the things that's key in recovery is developing that independent thought and that independent sense of self. Because when we're vulnerable to other people's ideas, other people's suggestions, other people's, you know, well, if you do this, then it's not until we start to see ourselves as that unique individual. And I think social media helps us think of ourselves en masse. And I think it's very, very important for myself that I stay off most social media because I don't want to be influenced super heavily by other people's unhealthy patterns. Mm-hmm. That's important.
But how would you advise someone who is at the most impressionable age of, let's say, 13 or something, how not to fall for all those insta-famous skinny people who tell you to fast and cleanse and detox and quit sugar? And, you know, there are people who tell you to live off of air and sunshine and they get media coverage. So for fuck's sake, there's no stability in a 12, 13, 14-year-old. And how can we teach them not to fall for it? Because I would fall for it as well.
So would I. And I think I did in my own, and you may have experienced this too. The media was its own animal when we were younger, and it's much more pervasive now. And I think that what I would tell a younger person is that you can watch all the YouTube, you can watch all the Instagram, you can see all of this stuff until you're blue in the face. Is that going to develop your life at all? Or is that simply going to teach you how to cleanse? And then there's this question of like, do I care? I think that elemental piece where we decide what is our value as people and how do I want to be of value to the world, I think that's pretty key because while I was still convinced that those things were inherent priorities, I believed it. I believed it. And until I developed my own priorities and sense of purpose, I would not have found a way to get past all of that influence. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I know what you mean, but I still think that for a 13-year-old, it's like you and I are screaming into the void. Don't listen to that. Keep your own voice, keep your own mind, make your own choices. But the whole world is literally, and maybe even the parents, are teaching those kids, you know, don't get too fat and don't eat this, or you have to finish your plate, or all the exercise programs that are called insanity and boot camp, and I don't know all the names, but I've heard some terrible names that basically just bring the pain in their name to the game. So you kind of grow up with the idea that you have to hurt yourself. You have to burn food. You have to earn food. You have to look a certain way to even be accepted in your peer group.
Yes. And that, I mean, I think one of the things that can help is stuff like your show. Really, I know that sounds odd coming right in the middle of things, but it's so vital that women who have thought these things through and men who have thought these things through and come out the other side, that we become as powerful an example as the mutual self-destruction of very young people. I think that we have to create a culture where young people have a different example to look to. And if we don't create that, we're leaving them in the dark, and they have to feel their way through the dark and find whatever handholds they can. And I think that people our age and certainly even younger and older, we need to be making a different, much more vocal example of what healthy actually looks like.
Oh, yeah. Sadly, the whole pop culture goes in a totally different direction. You know, the hypersexualization of people's bodies in music videos and, you know, even when you buy, someone told me that they saw an ad for a scale and that even on the ad, the scale had a very low number on it. So that it basically implied that either you get to that low weight when you buy the scale or you that would be an ideal weight. So, you know, all the suggested, the subliminal messages everywhere. And even I think when I look around, I see overall women are getting skinnier and heavier, but you know that we seem to lose the normal.
Yes.
And there are so many skinny women that I feel, and it, they have an energy about them. And I'm not skinny shaming anyone. I'm talking about those people who you can just feel that they are in a fearful place and that they are very concerned about not gaining weight. Because I know skinny women, very few, but skinny women who are comfortable and who have a totally normal relationship with food and they can eat cake and everything. They're just themselves and they have an easy energy about them. And there are so many people out there nowadays that I just feel are, you know, tight inside and compulsive and afraid.
I think that fear is the key piece. I think that anxiety that you do sense around people who are having struggles internal with themselves, having that internal battle with themselves of, I am not good enough. I have to do this differently. I have to control myself. I have to do all these things. That becomes a life purpose in itself. And it becomes a continuous state of anxiety that you can't escape until you step back and listen to, there's got to be some inner truth in there. You know, in all of us, I do believe there is a deeper self. Social influences cannot be our only source of information. And even young people can grasp, what do I want to do with my life? How do I want to make a difference? I think it's important to provide that counterpoint of those people with that terribly, terribly afraid energy. I think other people need to really speak up about balanced energy, keeping grounded, staying centered in one's sense of purpose. And getting out of that sense of, I have to be a size, because that's actually really irrelevant, you know, to our lives.
And when I say that to someone who might be struggling, then I often get the reaction that it must be very closely related to their self-worth, because the idea, you know, either they're very resistant, because that's just what we do, what are you talking about? Or it is like, but I have to do this. Because otherwise I will be exposed as a mistake or not good enough and people will not love me. And I can so relate to that fear. But is it really true that we all have to hit rock bottom before we finally admit to ourselves that there might be another truth than the one that tells us we're not worthy? You know, the inner voices that tell us we're shit.
Right. I think it's not true. I think we don't all have to hit rock bottom. I've met many people who are on their way down, not necessarily numerically, but on their way down a spiral, who listened. I think there's that elemental listening process of hearing people who've been there before say, you don't need to go there. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. You can choose a different path. And it's not a matter of telling them the most horrible story in the world. It's a matter of saying, this is what I've found on the other side. You can skip the hell. You can really just skip over it and move on with your life, you know?
Yeah, that's what Virgie Tovar said. It's like with the fat acceptance movement, they're saying people get so enraged because they've been invested all their life in their chase of the thin dream. And when someone cuts in front of the line and says, I'm going to just cut out the middleman and be happy right now, that people get so angry because they held on to this belief for so long that it seems outrageous that someone should be happy and sexually satisfied and healthy in a bigger body.
Yes, as they are. I mean, I think I had a wonderful psychiatrist once who said to me, when I was having a real difficulty with self-loathing thoughts, she said, you know, the thing is, figure out who you are and then do it on purpose. I loved that. I just thought, you know, that's true of the body. That's true of our personalities. That's true of who we are or where we come from, is this sense that I am going to be who I want to be because that is who I'm made to be. You know what I mean? It's, I can't make myself have a different body. I can't make myself have a different mind or self. I think the key to my own sense of peace of mind is an enormous level of acceptance of what I am. You know, humility is important in that, and recognizing that's all I am. And I don't need to be more than that. I don't need to be better, more perfect, thinner, bigger, smaller. It doesn't make any difference. What I am is this interior self. And when I pay attention to that self, I'm happy. And I think that's key, is that we forget that we get to be happy. We get to be content. We get to have peace of mind, because culturally we're informed that we have to be chasing something all the time. We have to be in pain, wanting something more. And when you just allow yourself to be yourself, people really do go, how can you do that? Well, I can do it because I decided I felt like it, you know? And it's not an easy choice to make. It requires enormous retraining of the mind, but it is the example I need to give to younger people for myself too.
And when you say you have to be yourself and know yourself, then I want to ask the question, or maybe it's just my own experience, it's not so easy to figure out who I really am after a lifetime of performing some idea of what I thought was expected from me. And I don't know what you have to say about the process of finding out who we really are.
I read a lot, and I still read a lot. I read a lot of writers, thinkers, philosophers who talk about their process of coming to themselves, coming to acceptance, coming to peace of mind. I have sought long and hard for those voices, and they are out there. You know, they are out there, those people who say, this is who I am, and I claim that, and I celebrate that. They aren't the loudest voices, but they're there. And I have found that I couldn't have come up with a sense of confidence or a sense of self-worth on my own. I needed to seek that out. But the process of seeking that out has been enormously rewarding and healing for me. And then, of course, you have to go to therapy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, therapy is my saving grace.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's critical.
Yeah. For people who don't know about mental health issues or not a whole lot about it, what do you want the world to know about bipolar disorder?
It's not a death sentence. It's just a name. It helps me, the name helps me understand elements of how my mind works. When I limit myself to that diagnosis, though, and when people limit me to it, when people say, oh, you have bipolar, end of story, I get very irritated, because I'm like, no, that's an aspect. That's like saying, well, you're short, end of story, and you have brown hair. That's all. It's ridiculous. You know, it's an element of who we are. We are very, very complex people. By definition, people are complex. So what I want people to know about bipolar disorder, mental illness of any kind, mental health struggles, is that it is not the end. It is the beginning of a journey of healing. That's really, truly what I believe.
And a lot of people don't know the difference between bipolar 1 and 2 and rapid cycle bipolar. So would you explain that just for general information?
Sure. Bipolar 1 indicates that you have had at one point or another a manic break, and that your mood swings are wider. You go higher, you go lower. Bipolar 2, you tend to run in a narrower sine wave of mood swings, but they're often faster. You may experience more depression than someone who has bipolar 1, but you won't experience the full manic breaks. And so does that sort of answer that question?
Yeah, I think what a lot of people don't understand is, you know, the extent of what a manic episode can look like and what it really feels like. And so I think you're the right person to ask about that.
Sure, sure. Manic breaks for about a minute feel thrilling. Then they feel serrated. They feel incredibly painful. You cannot slow your mind down. You cannot slow your words down. You cannot slow your thoughts. You do things very, very impulsively. You do silly, sometimes dangerous things. And it's as if you're watching yourself spin out of control and you can't stop it. That's the helpless feeling of a manic break, is that you can't stop yourself by force of will. And that's frightening, because we're told, you know, pull yourself together, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, whatever. And with a manic break, you simply can't. You need to immediately get that assistance in breaking up the cycle of mania and depression.
Mm-hmm. And I heard that many people have these ideas of grandiosity, grandiose delusions, thinking that yes, they're the Messiah or doing. I had an interview with Chris Cole, and he was stripping down naked in a prison cell after he was arrested because he was, you know, self-medicating as well, of course, because right, he was in right, pain. And that exacerbated everything. And then he completely lost his mind, air quotes, and he really did. And he showed all the police men his genitals, asking them if it was too big, too small, blah, blah, blah. And he was getting himself into this whole idea that he was going to save the world and he had to, you know, build a group of disciples and everything. And that is a typical thing for bipolar one, but not bipolar two.
Correct. Correct. Bipolar two, to the best of my knowledge, does not have elements of psychosis, whereas bipolar 1 sometimes does slip into those psychoses of delusions of grandeur or a sense that one is all-powerful or all-knowing. Psychosis, the more research they do on it, the more bipolar 1 looks more like a psychotic disorder and less like a mood disorder. Knowing those things about what makes a disorder what it is will help us enormously in diagnosing and treating in the future.
Mm-hmm. You, at one point, I think you wrote that if you had known better, or if you didn't drink or use substances as much, or, you know, stay up all night and drink 7 tons of coffee a day, whatever it was, then you might have stopped the bipolar 2 from turning into bipolar 1. Is that still a valid thing to say, to assume that one can have bipolar 2 and by exacerbating or, you know, self-harming even more, that can turn into bipolar 1?
Well, I think what we don't know is what exactly causes that transition. They don't know the mechanism in the mind that switches over from having bipolar 2 into having that full manic break. Generally, they know it's a stressor. And a stressor can be physiological, it can be substances, or it can be external, it can be trauma. Those factors that we experience in life, if we already have that vulnerability, those are risk factors. And so if I had taken better care of myself, yes, I think I would have been much less vulnerable later on to becoming seriously manic.
Mm-hmm. And you didn't really get the most helpful advice on your way.
No, I didn't.
Oh, my God. So how do you, you know, handle and manage your mood and your mind these days?
Well, they're pretty agreeable. I take a very, very exceptionally effective cocktail of medications. They're very effective for me. They keep me from having the high moods and the low moods. I still would say I'm, you know, like we said at the beginning, I'm a sensitive human being, however we want to define that. So emotionally, I have a wide range. That doesn't anymore frighten me. It doesn't scare me to have that variability of mood and thought and everything like that. So what it is there's these elements. There's the physiological stabilization, there's emotional retraining, there's thought retraining, that's therapy. How do we go through that process? Really, the thing that keeps me on level is that combination of things. There is no one treatment for any disorder or for any two people even. But I feel very lucky in that I have developed some coping skills. I meditate, I walk, I have great relationships, I have a good therapist. All of these pieces that you can put in place help protect you from what may boil up, and they help you cope when it does.
And part of the grieving process, or for me at least, is also to come to terms with the fact that I will never be able to expose myself to as much pressure as someone who is quote-unquote normal would.
That's, I think that recognition that I can't do everything that I'd like to do is also, I mean, I might say, okay, that's an element of having a disorder, but it's also an element of being human. Everybody's got limitations. I'm never going to play basketball. I'm 5 feet tall. You know, I mean, there's elements where I go, okay, well, there are certain stressors I'm not going to take on because I don't want the fallout. And I think if more people were kinder to themselves and put themselves under less negative and unnecessary pressure, we'd have less crisis. I do feel we would have less crisis if people took better care of themselves.
That's why I think it's so harmful that we are living in a society that basically promotes this image of people who go, go, go all the time, and then they hurt themselves almost in their yes. workout routines, and then they work all day and they have endless to-do lists and morning routines and evening routines. And,
yeah.
and it seems like, wow, I got to live up to that. And as I said, for years I tried that and did that and completely wrecked the energy resources that I had, and it exacerbated everything, but I couldn't stop because I thought, well, I'm close and I want to be more like them, so I have to overexert myself, which yes. in the end led to a breakdown.
Yes, and it does. The more stress you put on the self, in the same way as if you put enough stress on a bone, it'll break. You know, I mean, we're not infallible. We're not unbreakable. We're very, very sensitive beasts. We're organisms. We have flaws. We have limitations. We have ways in which we can't do everything we would like to do. But we do absolutely live in a culture that says, do it all. You must do it all. It's not even optional. It's a mandatory situation where you have to do everything. Mm-hmm. And eventually, you just have to step out of that game. You know, you have to say, I don't choose to live my life in constant anxiety and stress. There is another way to live. There are lots of other ways to live.
Yeah, that's true. But it takes a lot of self-awareness to even know, hey, I'm being presented this game here. I do not have to participate. But it wasn't possible for me, certainly, when I was like maybe 25 or something. It was just, I want to belong.
Yes, yes. There's a very deep desire to belong. And I certainly felt the same way. And what you find, I think, and I'm sure you may well experience the same thing, is that when you step away, the people playing the game are not the only people in the world. And you can find a really deep community outside of that game. And I have found so many people who have taught me how to have peace of mind, have friendships, have relationships, have a love of my work instead of a compulsion to my work. Those people are out there. And it really is a matter of cultivating who do you spend time with and how do you choose to live. And I know these sound vague, but eventually we do have to take them a little bit to heart and question our commitment to the game.
Yeah, that's very wise. And I think you touched on a very important topic, or that's what I heard, about finding our tribe and finding our people and not trying to be like other people, but finding yes. the ones that understand us and take us as we are. And that's not an easy process, I must say, because there are fewer of them. You know, those are not the millions of people that loved, you know, my personality on the radio. Those are actually very few people.
I have found that if I keep seeking them, I keep finding them.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like that tribe is ever growing, whether it's growing in the world or not. But I do know that in my experience, the more I open myself to people and ask them, what's your life like? You know, who are you? Instead of trying to go, am I as good as you? Am I measuring up to you? Do I look like you? When I stop living comparatively and start living empathetically, I meet people who are just astounding. You know, I meet those people every day, and many of them are my tribe. You know, they are my tribe. And so I think if I sought it in media, if I went on Facebook and tried to find all my best friends, I would struggle. But gradually, you do find those people with whom you resonate like a tuning fork. They ring and you ring, you know. And I think it's a beautiful process. And it isn't easy. It's not like being younger and wanting your clique. It's not like that. It's really recognizing that those people will be deep and longtime friends. You just have to find them.
Yeah, it is. And for a while, it can be a bit lonely when you go from, you know, having a million friends and being very yeah. popular and going out all the time and then finding yourself and maybe finding out that...
Yes, it can get a little lonely. But I also think I'm working on a book right now, a collection of essays about women's lives and solitude. I think we're taught to be afraid of solitude. I think we're taught to be afraid of being alone. And I actually quite welcome a certain amount of solitude, and loneliness is just one of those feelings you feel, you know? It's not the absolute antithesis of happiness. Lonely is just an experience, you know? It's one of those things that you go through and you go, oh, here I am with myself. We need to get to know each other a little better, I guess. And so finding ways to grapple with loneliness and to make friends with solitude, I think, has been one of the deepest healing experiences in my life.
For me too. I mean, it was part of, you know, my starting to recover. And after my breakdown, I was faced with a lot of free time or being by myself and facing loneliness. And sometimes that is very painful because I have to reestablish a new circle of friends and people I can be open with. And I live in a country where, you know, issues are not talked about. They're right. Being openly swept under the rug. And if I don't play along nicely, then I find myself pretty lonely. And especially, you know, being a person that at one stage in her life had to be the popular one and everybody was sort of admiring me for something I wasn't really. And that is a painful process. It's not like the people are out there waiting for me to show up honestly, not right. The masses. So loneliness is a double-edged sword, and I think you are very right that I learned how to be alone, and I love that I am able to be that, but for me, it kind of switched into the opposite direction where I tended to isolate much too much and did everything by myself and in a compulsive way, exercising compulsively and food rules and not going out and losing my spontaneity. And then, you know, the disorders, they want us for themselves.
True. Well put. They do. They do. And I think the only thing I know as undisordered is the middle. You know, I don't always tend toward the middle and balance, but if I'm with people constantly, I'm not well. If I'm alone all the time, I'm not well. There really has to be that give and take of human contact and connection and solitude that allows me to kind of go back into myself, restore, and go out into the world again. And isolating doesn't allow for that connection, and I need it. But at the same time, constantly connecting doesn't allow for the solitude. And so again, it becomes about balance.
Yeah, amen. What does resilience mean to you?
It means making a choice. I think that's really what it means, is like you have the opportunity to make a choice of how you want to live. That doesn't mean you choose what you came with or the assets you have or the advantages you've had. It means you choose to work with what you've got and make a life for yourself. And I've seen so many people do that. I see children do that. I see older folks do that. And when people have that moment where they go, I want something good for myself, we find a way to do that. We find ways to be with people. We find ways to get help. We find ways to build tools for ourselves. Resilience to me is about adaptability and about deciding that you want something good for yourself.
Oh, there's so much hope in what you just said. So beautiful. It really is. Yeah. And as you know, we're living in a culture that basically all day long tells us to be happy, have a wonderful, super great day, and be skinny, and then you will be happy, and buy this gadget and be happy, and, you know, all the distractions and everything is linked to happiness. Do this, and then you will be happy or happier. So I want to ask you, because I respect you and your journey, what do you personally feel constitutes a happy life?
Peace of mind. Oh. Peace of mind. You know, it's not that euphoria. There's a great Calvin and Hobbes cartoon. I don't know if you know Calvin and Hobbes, but yeah, it's sure. A great cartoon. It's this little boy who says one day, happiness is not enough. I demand euphoria. And I think that's really what we do a lot of the time. You know, and Hobbes, of course, his tiger is like rolling his eyes. But the fact is that happiness is a very middle state. It's a state of equilibrium to me. I think euphoria is lovely for when it comes, and it doesn't need to stay. I think, you know, needing that constant rush is a way to be unhappy, because life is not a constant rush. Life is not always rips and joys. You know, it's not always sunshine and rainbows, as you say. It is, however, always interesting. And I think when I come to a point where I'm always alert for what new interesting thing is happening, that is when I can be happy.
Yeah, and not expecting to be happy all the time is also a way to be happier.
True, so true, so true.
So what are you working on? I found it a bit confusing, the information that I found, because I want to know what reading do I have to do to, you know, to catch up and what is lining up.
Well, right now I'm wrapping up a book that comes out next June. It's on a 5-year kind of quest I took to study mental health in America, but it certainly applies around the world. It looks at where we are with neuroscience, with psychiatry, and with recovery. And it looks at how will we build a better future for ourselves in terms of mental health. So I profile a lot of individuals who are healing and in the recovery process. I profile psychiatrists. I profile neuroscientists. It's all about the journey that I took that really taught me so much about how people, as you just said, about how people persevere, how they're resilient, and how they heal. So that's that book. It comes out next June. I'm almost done. The one after that, I'm completing a book of essays about women in solitude. And after that, there's a collection of poems.
All right. I read someplace that you were having some ideas of writing something about sexuality as well. I would have been interested in having your take on that, but I'm not even sure if it's true.
It is not something I've worked on for a few years, but for a few years I was starting to compile some essays on that, on literature and sexuality, actually. The experience of falling in love with books and how that translates into the rest of our lives. But that's something that I had to put on the back burner because I did start this research and I will eventually write it, but we're not there yet.
Thank God. I mean, you have a lot of years to come and you have one reader over here that is always happy for you to publish books, basically. Oh,
that means the world to me. That means just the world to me. Thank you.
So before I ask you my final question, I want to let you tell everyone where they can find you if they want to find out about your work and what you do.
Sure. My website is mariahornbacher.com and my books are available on any online portal. And so you can always find those, but they're also on my website. You would buy them through, my hope is, an independent source rather than a massive monopoly. But you can find out about me at mariahornbacher.com.
Very nice. My final question is always the same for everybody, so it will be for you as well. What would you like to be remembered for?
Laughter. I'd like to be remembered for bringing people laughter.
And how do you do that? Because you do. Even in the darkest reading moments, I found myself chuckling and laughing out loud. And I love this combination. And it's so rare. It's either darkness and gloomy, doomy stuff, or it is, you know, playing it over the top. But you have this wonderful mixture in your writing that makes me want to laugh and cry with you at the same time.
Good. I thank you. That's really that's the note I hope to strike, is that sense of, to me, that's real. You know, things are dark sometimes. Things are funny sometimes, sometimes at the same time, you know? And so that note to me is that note of realness in our lives, is where there's a balance and there's a give and take, and we have to laugh and we have to cry.
We do. Let's end on that note. Thank you, Marya, for doing this. This has been amazing.
It has been amazing. Thank you so much, Merit.
This was today's dose of badassery from Life Unrestricted. Find the show notes with links to everything we mentioned in this episode over at lifeunrestricted.org. And if this show is making you feel good, awesome, make sure to subscribe and please let others feel good too. By leaving a 5-star review on iTunes, you'll help make this show more visible and therefore more accessible for others. You're the best. Thanks.